string set that the abstraction to finding the solutions to these values that we could find the case. In the case of strings, we can be able to stack the backups with it.
Abstraction to finding the cosmic transformation, those are not the patterns. That pull diagrams was the obstruction to finding the classical solution to equation. Right?
No, you said that this goes smooth.
Yes. No, because the point is, if the Goldschmidt occurred, that basically will mean that the you will see breakdown of spots. What its consequences is another matter, right? That may or may not happen. I mean, typically, if superstring is broken, you may get dipoles. But there may be other situations where even so, after superstring is broken, you don't have dipoles.
But from the wall sheet level, there is no way to see these
whether
the global
superstring. You will see that the superstring water entities are not valid. Yes, the amplitude, the bosons and formulas are not equal.
Same order that we find obstruction to this solution, the same order which this animal is going to take.
So, breaking of supersymmetry is not an inconsistency of the pattern, right? That's why you don't expect to see divergences. Whereas, having a non-zero one-point function, right, tells us that the vacuum itself is inconsistent. And that's why you encounter divergence, right? So, the theory is easy. Yeah, so once you can be broken, the theory can still be perfectly right. Okay, so today we are going to give the world shape description of asymptotic heterotic, because after all, to do any string calculation, that's what we have to learn. First, let's consider the theory in flat space. But we'll organize the world shape fields in such a way that it makes it easier to make generalize it to curved space. Okay, in particular, compacting based on Calabi-Yorkin fields. So the ghosts, we don't have anything more to say about because they are the usual. The ghost structure doesn't change as you change the background. So the beta, gamma, BC, B bar, C bar are exactly as you have learned. Matter sector is what knows about what background you are considering. So if you are working in flat background, the matter sector we can write as a set of four scalars, okay, which will eventually become the non-compact directions. These are scalars. Here partner formulas. These are formulas. These are, let's say, light moving formulas. Because you're considering the topic. Then we have the left moving formulas. Here I will take I to be from 1 to 26. Then we add to the list xn for me again equal to 4 to 9. These are again scalars. Psi n. And lambda I for I equal to 27 2 these will be left. Now, of course, if you are working with really class space theory, right, then you will group the xn's and xn's together, the psi u's and psi m's together, and the lambda is together. Okay? And all the fields will be free. Okay? Free scalars, free particles. But in the interacting theory, when you have compactification on tab, your manifold, these still remain free fields. So these remain free fields with these transforming under the space-time Lorentz group, SO3, 1, okay, or SO4 if you are working in Euclidean formalism. And these are the fundamentals of SO26, okay, the unbroken SO26 group, right? These transform are the fundamentals of SO26. These fields together become interacting. That's what happens when you put it in the Calabi of
Adam.
You can write down the world shape theory in the Calabi of Adam manifold, right? And you will find that these remain free. Okay? I mean, why XMs are interacting is clear to see, right? Because XMs are the coordinate associated with the compact axis. Right? Psi Ms are the support partners, so these also are easy to see why they are interacting. Lambda is interacting because of the fact that we also switch on a gauge connection. The lambdas don't couple to the background partition. Okay? But lambdas couple to gauge fields. Right? Because to begin with, the 32 lambdas were transforming as a 32 representation of SO particle. Okay? So once you have switched on the gauge field background, right, and write on the world shape sigma model, you will find that the lambdas become interacting. And in particular, for the class of compactifications that we are considering, when the spin connection is identified as to the gauge connection, okay, that you have the, you pick the SU3 holonomy spin connection and set the gauge fields to be equal to that. So for those class of compactification, this is in fact left-right symmetric. Left-right symmetric. And it in fact has 2-2 wires as possible. This left-right symmetry is accidental. Okay? It comes because of the identification of spin connection to gauge connection. Okay? And that's essentially what guarantees that you treat the left and right moving coordinates in the same way. So psi m is coupled to background curvature, lambda is coupled to background gauge field strength. Okay, but when you put them together, you find that psi m and lambda have equal identical coupling. Because the background curvature and background gauge field strength have been identified. Right? They have been said to be equal to each other. And that's what makes this. So this 2-2 wire-shaped symmetry, or the fact that the theory is left-right symmetric, is a special feature of this class of background. Okay, where you embed the spin connection to the gauge connection. In general, this is not like this. And the super symmetry that you will get on the world sheet is what is called a 0-2 super symmetry. Now, for later use, we will need some OPs. Just let me mention a few of them. Okay, the others will write down how you will need it. Okay, we'll be using alpha prime equal to 1 next. So del x mu of z, del x mu of w is minus 1 over 2. Plus these are non-singular terms. Psi u of z. The field part, and similarly for the conjugates. Okay, del bar x times del bar x will have z bar minus 1 bar square, lambda lambda will have 1 over z bar minus 1. And the p part of the world shape theory, or well, let me write the total p, will be minus w nu. Means the interacting part of the state tensor. PF, which is the super partner of the state tensor, is okay. Similarly, we can write down P bar. Now, because we have two world shapes in SUSY, the internal superstring transfer actually is bigger, it's not just T and TF. So, what one has in the internal superstring transfer is B internal output, this is the energy moment. Instead of having a single TF, we have Df plus minus. So, okay, because of n equal to 2, which are two supersymmetric generators. So, Tf plus minus. And there is also an R symmetry, J. And because it's also left hand symmetric, you should similarly have P bar in front of it. P bar plus minus. And J bar. Pardon? Yes, that's the same. Because that's the internal energy momentum tensor, and I'm just saying that the internal energy momentum tensor is part of a bigger algebra which contains D, D plus minus, and okay. And the Tf that I wrote down there, okay, this is what appears, for example, in the expression for picture changing operator. Because the picture changing operator is introduced based on arbitrary background, right? It doesn't care about whether you have background preserving space time supersymmetry or not space time supersymmetry, right? So that should know separately about Tf plus and Tf minus. Okay, it just knows about Tf. So Tf that appears there is just Tf plus plus Tf minus.
This,
yes.
This two SUSY generators.
Yes.
Should be the full Tj and Tf, right? But it separates, factorizes into two direct sum of CFTs, one internal and one Minkowski.
Yeah, so 2-2 supersymmetry is only for the internal one. This is for internal.
For the free CFT is not.
For the free CFT, okay, if you want, you can try to extend it to 2 supersymmetry, but it's not very natural because you can see the left and right have different number of formulas, right? We have psi mu, but we have lambda is 26 in number.
So it's 1-0.
Yeah, you can think of as 0-1. Right moving supersymmetry, right? I mean, as I said, you can pick a subset of those and define a supersymmetry generator, but it's not very useful. So, and the point is that these, see, eventually in all the expressions, only these will apply, right? Because the feature changing operator, for example, can is only Tf. It's just that if you, because the internal CFT is interacting, right? You don't have direct access to the correlation functions. So for this reason, it's useful to have a bigger algebra, because you can use various identities in forming correlation functions, even though we cannot sometimes explicitly compute the correlation function because it's an interacting CFT. That's why it's useful to what think in terms of TF plus and TF minus. For a free part, right, we work with del x mu. Each del x mu, for example, is separately a new one generator. So you have a lot of extra chiral algebra. Yeah, but it's a free theory anyway, so all correlation functions can be explicitly compute for the x mu sign. Okay, it's for the internal CFT that it's useful to have the knowledge of the general structure and their OPs, because often that's all you have. Right? You don't have explicit information about the correlation. Is this point here? Yeah, because Galileo manifolds will give interacting two-dimensional fields. Right? Sometimes there are special points on the Galileo moduli space where the theory is exactly solvable, but it's not in general.
Pardon?
The TF. TF, well, F is a formulaic super partner. It stands for formula. Okay. It's a formulaic part of the set extension.
So, but you have already included sin mu, del sin mu in TZ.
Yes. So, this is a free part. This is a free part of the. You see, this is still bosonic. So, TF doesn't mean that it's a contribution to the set extension for the formulas. Right? EF means it's the formulaic partner of the state sensor, the analog of the psi mu del x mu. So this is a contribution from the free part. Right? There will also be a contribution from the interacting part. That's what I'm calling EF. Okay. So if it was actually toroidal compact configuration, for example, it would have been psi m del x mu. Right? But in a Galileo, it's a much more complicated object, and that's what it is. Is this here? EF is the formulaic, is the super partner of the energy. It's not the formulaic contribution to the energy. That's psi mu del x. That's all included in sizes.
Sir, you made some comment about because we are in dealing with interacting CFT, so
yes.
Hence we cannot, we cannot calculate all the correlation functions. So what was, you mentioned something about the algebra.
Yeah, that but nevertheless, for many manipulations, you need relationship between correlation functions.
Yes.
Right? And for this, having a chiral algebra helps, because having chiral algebra allows you to relate various correlation functions.
Okay.
Right? Often you may not have to calculate things explicitly,
okay,
but just find the relations using the extended chiral algebra.
Okay.
Right? Whereas if you really had a free theory, then you could calculate explicitly anyway. Then you could either try to relate them or just directly use the result of the calculation. That is only when you don't have access to direct calculation that it becomes useful to make use of as large chiral algebra that you have.
You mentioned issues require equal information about TF.
Yes.
Okay, TF includes
the interaction. Yes, TF includes the interaction. Okay. There is a free part of this. Then if you remember the expression for the PCO that I wrote down earlier, yeah, there is an e to the phi TF kind of contribution, right? That TF is this. Yeah, there is a free part and then this is the interaction. Okay. So some useful information. That the J charge will play an important role. J is a U1 current, right? So for every field or operator, you can ask for its charge under J. Right? And the way you define the charge is that you take the OP of J of Z with that operator at W and pick the single pole. Coefficient of the single pole term is a charge. Right? Or you take an operator and you integral JZ DZ around the operator, that gives a charge. So TF plus has J charge plus 1 and T df minus as
the factor.
This
doesn't
well, we'll see that this essentially is the art chart that levels the entire superfluid. Right now, you just think of this as a charge energy. Now, if just in order to keep in your mind what these objects are, right, let me just say that in the limit of large volume gravity, okay, so if we are the theory almost fit, right, what are these TF plus and TF minus? So the difference between TF and TF plus and TF minus is the TF plus is something like psi m radix m bar. That you take these six coordinates and make them into three complex coordinates. Okay, Calabi manifold is a complex manifold, so it's natural to use complex coordinates. So call these m's complex coordinates, so m runs from 1 to 3. So TF plus is the analog of psi m del x m bar, and this is the analog of psi m bar. Okay. And in this language, the J essentially counts the formula number, okay, with psi m's being counted as charge 1 and psi m bars being counted as charge minus 1. Okay. This is an intuitive idea you may try to keep in mind. I mean, what you think of is just think of this as a toroidal compactification, okay, but restrict to only a subsector, okay, which survives when you go to Calabi, right? Say by taking order of orders. So roughly it is, okay, TF plus and TF minus are roughly this. But if you consider a general Calabi where you have switched on actual switch on the Calabi of Eckley, and then there are directions to this. Now, these TF bar plus minus is now, are not going to play too much of a role in what we are going to discuss, because TF bar never really appears in any of the correlation functions, because the picture thing occurs only in what TF. And the reason is that the original Worship superspectrum was really 0-1 superspectrum, right? That's what we gauge in hydraulic. The fact that we have this 2-2 superspectrum, this superspectrum on the left, is just an accident on the background. So the PCO also have no knowledge about TF plus and TF minus. In a generic background, then, which doesn't preserve any supersymmetry, there will be no analog of TF bar at all. Right? And also, there will be no analog of TF plus and TF minus separately, but TF will always appear. Because 0-1 super conformal symmetry is necessary even to formulate the circuit.
In 2B, you will need.
In 2B, yes, you will need TF minus. In the 2B or 2A, the picture that you occur, so it will both TF and TF bar. But this J bar actually plays a role. Okay. So J bar is the analog of K, right? So similarly, if you just put the bars on top of this, okay, those are the J bar charts. So J bar, in fact, is the current associated with unbroken E1. So let me make this more specific what this means. So this basically means, for example, that if U1 needs to be modified. Epsilon mu, this is a polarization. C bar C. Okay. So from the right moving or the holomorphic side, K would be P to the minus pi psi B. From the anti-holomorphic side, it would be J bar. If you had replaced J bar by del bar X nu, you would have gotten the graviton match. So the structure of a vortex of water, okay, is this, that if you have graviton, then it will be a psi nu del bar X nu. Right? If you have gauge field, then it's psi nu J bar. If you want the SO26 gauge field vortex of water, right? Then this J bar will have to be replaced by J bar A. Right? Where J bar A are the SO current generators. What are those? J bar A will be lambda I P A by J lambda J. Okay, sum by J from order 26. And you can also construct the holomorphic currents out of the lambdas, the phi lambdas, right, which are part of the phi, part of the action. If you replace this J bar by J bar A, you will get the corresponding action for the SO26 regions. Okay. But you can see from this that this U R is a little different from the graviton vortex of water or the SO26 gauge field vortex of water, in the sense that this actually involves an interacting part of the CFA. Yeah, this J bar really is part of an interacting CFA. Unlike the SO26 vortex of water, these are just phi formulas. Yeah, these are not interacting. So these are really constructed out of phi formulas. That's not the case for the U. What is? This is the generator of SO26. This is numbers. This is numbers. Okay. Generators. Yeah, of SO26. Yeah, I'll just give you an example of how the various kinds of vortex of water are constructed. Okay. The U1, okay, which will be of our interest, is this one. Okay, now let me talk about the spin fields. Again, we'll focus on the matter sector only. Okay. And just to make life simple, I'll consider the equilibrium here. Okay, but well, you can generalize it to the Lorentz. So the way one goes about constructing spin fields is that first you define, you polarize, you make the formulas. Okay, so these are real formulas, eh? Real right moving formulas. You combine them into complex formulas, psi 0 plus I psi 1, and then you can polarize them by declaring this is I phi 1. Yeah. Similarly, psi 2. Psi psi 3 is equal to I plus 2. And then the spin fields are constructed from here as e to the power I by 2 plus minus 5. Classify into two classes, sigma 4 alpha and sigma 4 alpha dot. Alpha stands for B even number of minus signs. And this one stands for odd number. So there are four different components here, right? Plus minus or plus minus. Four different spin fields you can introduce. Two of them are classified as sigma for alpha. Okay, alpha runs for two values. Two of them are classified as sigma for alpha dot. And the difference between alpha and alpha dot is that sigma for alpha. Okay, these contain only either both plus or both minus signs, whereas these contain one plus one. These are spin fields. This is what we call a spin field. Right? This is the definition. That these fields are called a spin field. And while labeling them as sigma 4 alpha and sigma 4 alpha dot, where alpha takes 2 values and alpha dot takes 2 values. And the 4 stands for the fact that there are 4 diagonal spin fields. Yeah? Because they have just modularized this 4 formula. Now we introduce the six dimensional spin field. Again, we have to recall that the six dimensional spin fields are directly average, are difficult to define directly because the formulas are not free. But let's suppose for the time being that we ignore interaction, we treat the things as free, and then see what kind of spin fields we can get. So then we again, most nice, pretending. We can modulize psi 4 plus pi psi 5 and we can give r pi 3 psi 6 plus pi psi 7 plus pi 4 plus psi 5 plus pi 5. And then, of course, you can, if these are real free fields, you could introduce spin fields, there will be 2 cube number of spin fields, right? Because each can be combined with plus or minus sign. But it turns out that in the interacting theory, only two of them survive as general holomorphic field, which are denoted by sigma 6, which is e to the power I by 2, pi 3. 5 and sigma tilde 6, or let's call it sigma 6 c, or conjugate, so it will be minus I. Okay, in other words, what we are saying is that it is possible to generalize these spin fields that we construct from here in the full interacting theory. But only for two particular spin fields, sigma 6 and sigma 6. Okay, this you can in fact, the actual construction of these, you can also do in terms of the size of them. Okay, even though you have not done it, you don't really need to assume that there are free fields behind it. Okay. Just based on the existence of this algebra, okay, this J, this algebra, you can show that the theory you have, you can construct in the theory some spin fields which have this structure. And basically the way you do it is that you bosonize J. Okay, you write J as the I5. There, of course, J is already bosonic, but you can write J as some into the IH for some field H. Okay, and then you construct the spin field out of that field H. Okay, but we don't know, we need to go into the details. It's enough for us that we have these two spin fields that we can define. These are holomorphic spin fields. I should have written on the dimension. So these have dimension. These are dimension. By 8, which is 1/4. Let me just write it as 2/8. These are dimensions. Well, all these are all holomorphic, okay? So let me write 0 to 1/8 dimension. These have dimension 0, 3/8. Simply because it has three factors of e to the alpha 5/2, whereas these have only two factors of e to the alpha. That's the 2/8.
So this defining it as 5 3 plus 5 4 plus 5 5 is arbitrary, because 5 3 4 5 are not defined. You could have defined this as just e to the I/2 h or something.
Exactly. So you write g as e to the I/2 h. Right?
Speak to the e to the plus minus
I/2 h. Exactly. So you define g as e to the I/2 h. Sorry, not g as e to the i. You write g as del h. Okay, so j is
u1
pi.
U1, so del h.
Right? So you can write as j del h, where h is something like a free boson. And then you define the spin field as e to the plus minus I/2 h.
Because these first three equations, that don't hold for a
thing. Yeah, they don't certainly hold for general caravan. Right? Okay, these can be made a little more rigorous if you use all the forms, right? See, one part of the class of parabola of manifolds that you can get is just odd. So you start with a toroidal compactification and then take a Z3 odd. Okay. There you can actually make this more rigorous. Okay, this kind of concept. But otherwise, you have to directly deal the concept in terms of G. Okay, this is just an intuitive idea of what is going on. And from this, you can also guess what the G charge are. J charge see these are the complex formulas, right? So these all have J charge plus 1. Their conjugates will have J charge minus 1, right? If you look at this, see the psi, what I'm calling psi m here, right? The psi 1, psi 2, psi 3 are the three psi m's that appear here are the three combinations that are appearing. So the convention that you have used, each of these have J charge plus 1. So, e to the I5 3, e to the I5 4, and e to the I5 have J charge plus 1. So, these ones, when you take half of this, you will have J charge half. Yeah, and there are three of them. So, J charge of these, sigma 6, is 3 half, and sigma 6 C is minus 3. Okay, again, this is just an intuitive picture. Okay, if you want to get a more rigorous way of deriving this, you can go back to the definition of the spin fields in terms of Ozoy's version of J. And you can read out the J chart by because JJOP is known. Right? So you have to calculate UI H/2 and calculate the operator of J. Okay, and that's what will tell you what the J chart of these spin fields. Okay, but now you can just take it as given. Okay, this is an internal CFT, and these are two specific operators that are present in this internal conformal field with these charges. Is this clear? Now, of course, in any given situation, you don't deal with separately spin fields from each sector. Because when you talk about a Ramon sector, okay, a Ramon sector puts periodic boundary condition, okay, on all things at one, right? It puts periodic boundary condition on the internal formulons, on the free formulons, right, as well as the hosts, right? So the spin fields which are really present in the theory are combinations of internal formulas, the free formulas, and the host. Right? The spin fields of all of these will come together. But let me do it in steps. So first we combine the internal formula and the free formula. In case so we define sigma alpha as sigma 6 sigma alpha so these are declared to be GSU. Okay, again, this is a matter of convention. Okay? But once you have fixed a convention for one, then the rest are fixed. Okay, let us see why the rest are fixed. Okay. So, you see that from these relations, you can see that sigma 6c. If you want to get sigma 6 c from sigma 6, you have to take sigma 6 and calculate, or say, suppose you take sigma, you want to get sigma 6 from sigma 6 c, you have to take sigma 6 c, which is here, and take the product with this and this. Then that will convert into the minus I 5 by 2 to the plus I 5 by 2. So you can go from here to here by taking the product of sigma 6 c with these three formulas. Formulas are GSO. By declaration, right? They are the ones which have to be twisted. Right? Anything that is twisted in the Raman sector is declared to be GS odd, right? Because the GS odd fields are twisted, GS even fields are not twisted. Okay. So this means that if this is GS even, this must be GS odd and vice versa. Okay. So these two must carry opposite GS odd. Right? That's all you need. Is that clear? Similarly, between sigma 4 alpha and sigma 4 alpha dot, suppose you start with sigma 4 alpha at both minus signs. You go to sigma 4 alpha dot, you have to change one of the minus signs into plus sign. Okay? That means you have to take the OP with either equal to I 5 or equal to I 5. Both carry GSO, both are GSO odd operators, right? Because both are formulas. So that shows that sigma 4 alpha and sigma 4 alpha dot must have opposite GSO. But the two candidates for sigma 4 alpha, right, it will be minus I by 2 phi 1 plus phi 2, and it will be plus I by 2 phi 1 plus phi 2, they have the same GSO parity because you have to act with two formulas, right? If you want to go from it to the minus I by 2 phi 1 plus phi 2, you act with it to the I phi 1 times it to the I phi 2, right? That's a pair of formulas which is GSO even. So both components of sigma 4 carry the same GSO parity, both components of sigma 4 alpha dot carry the same GSO parity, but these carry opposite. So from this we see that once you have declared that this is GSU even, suppose you have declared that yes, this is GSU even, then this must also be GSU even because you have changed from sigma 6 to sigma 6 c, so this is opposite GSU parity, and you have changed from sigma alpha to sigma alpha dot, these also have opposite GSU parity. Is that clear? I should also define sigma tilde, these are the GS odd operators. So sigma tilde alpha dot is sigma 6, sigma 4 alpha dot, sigma tilde alpha is sigma 6, c alpha, d by GS odd. So now we have to look at the Bose sector. Okay, Bose sector basically means the xi eta phi sector. Okay. BC, BR, C bar are all called GSU even. So if you recall in the xi eta phi sector, right, xi and eta, we had already declared to be the sphere. Right? So there is nothing to do there. For e to the n phi, okay, we are declared it to be the so even for n is the so odd to be n. Okay, e to the phi, for example, is the so odd, right? E to the minus phi is the so odd, e to the minus 2 phi is the so. But now we are looking at the spin fields of the kind of ghost sector, which means exponentials with half integer times. Okay. So e to the 2n
minus 1.
2n
e to the 2n minus 1 phi.
So this is declared to be GSO given for n even and GS odd. Okay, again this is dependent on convention. You could have changed the definition, but once you have declared one to be GSO even, the other one has to be GS odd. Because you can multiply, you can go from one to the other by multiplying by e to the minus 5, right? And e to the minus 5 is declared to be GS odd. Right, so you have no choice. Is this clear? And eventually you have to make sure that the when you actually construct a string field, for example, right? String field must be composed of GSO even objects. Okay? Because GSO objects are all projected out anyway. So in writing of a string field in the Ramon sector, we have to combine what is required from the matter sector and the whole sector in such a way that the combination is always GSO. Okay? If during the manipulation you have encountered an operator which is GSO odd, okay, then that means that you have done something wrong. Okay? That you should never encounter an operator which is GSO odd, okay, when you are manipulating various expressions in string field theory, because you always work with GSO. So if you take two GSO even operators, their OP should always be GSO even. Right? You shouldn't, so it's closed under OP. Right? All the picture changing operators are by construction GSO even. Okay, so there is nothing that can change the GSO quantum operator. Right? The GSO parity is conserved. Right? So in all manipulations, once you have started with the string field that is GSO even, then all manipulations must always have only GSO even. Is this clear? So using this we can write down various useful vortex operators. So for example, the lowest order supersymmetric generator.
Or the low Wilson star.
Okay, these must exist because heterotic on Calabi out is supposed to preserve n equal to 1 supersymmetric. Right? At least to lowest order. So there should be a global supersymmetric transpose in parameter lowest order. And that is
given by C to the minus pi by 2 sigma.
Okay, this is supposed to belong to picture number minus half. Okay, it should be an element of H minus half, which it is. And you can check that it's yes so even because E to the minus pi by 2. Is GSO even because n is 0 and sigma alpha is GSO even, okay, as listed here. So this is a perfect table operator.
My name is totally on the sphere, that's why it's this path. But lowest order is G-string is such, you almost fear. That's what you mean lowest order.
That's it, yes. Because as we saw that you have to connect it to every order, right? The global superstring transformers, when you have, so this is, I mean, we wrote down lambda k yesterday, right? This is the k equal to 0.
So it's only sphere, basically. There's a sphere contribution.
These are sphere contributions, yes. So now the point is, so these will take the starting point, and then you have to iterate to try to generate the higher order connections, and then you have to see whether you run into an obstruction at some point of this. And basically, Lorentz invariance guarantees that if you run into an obstruction for any one alpha, you run into obstruction for all alphas. Right? Because you cannot have a less than n equal to 1 superstring. Right? Lorentz transformation will relate various superstring components. So either all of these will be broken or all of this will be broken. So it cannot happen in this case at least that for some alphas you will be able to extend it, for some other alphas you will not. Okay, the other useful operator that we'll need is the U1 Gaussian operator.
So while combining these matter sector speed fields and the host sector speed fields,
yes.
We have a principle that we should have Gaussian objects.
Yes.
And then we can have other combinations also, right? But one of them is the lowest order global superstring.
No, you can have other combinations where you can put sigma alpha dot. That's the other GSU. Right?
Oh, is it?
Yeah. So the GSU even operators are these two, right? Otherwise, you have to change this minus 5 by 2 to minus 3 5 by 2. So that sort of no number in the minus half picture. Right? Because you are looking for the global superstring transformation parameters in the minus sum picture, right? That's because when you wrote down the Gauss transformation relation, right? The non-trivial part of the Gauss transformation parameter was in the minus sum picture. Okay? Minus sum plus minus one. So you are looking at the minus sum picture. Okay? So that fixes the GSO transformation property of this point. Okay? So this is GSO. Once this part is fixed, this will know if other sigma alpha or sigma delta, sigma alpha. And those are the n equal to 1 superstring generator set. It has two, alpha component and alpha dot.
Like I've taken one GSO odd from the Gauss sector and the GSO odd from the matter sector for spin.
Yes, but I have a different picture number. And because the picture number has been fixed, there's not much you can. Yeah. Okay, so like you want Gaussian robotics operator, you can probably guess what it is. Let me write this as UG beta. Oh, I should have said that this has dimension 5. Right, because these were dimension 3,8, this is dimension 2,8. Okay, so total dimension of these is 5,8. And this is to the minus 5 by 2, you can calculate, okay, by using the formula that I had written down earlier. These are dimension 3,8. Okay, so together, this is dimension 1. C has dimension minus 1. So the full vortex of part is a dimension 0. Okay, this is a dimension 0 primary and it's in fact a BRC invariant. Okay, lambda naught is supposed to be a BRC invariant, right? Because UV lambda naught should be 0 in order for it to be global superstring generator. Okay, this one, okay, so this together again has dimension 1, dimension, let me write the 0, 1. This is dimension 1, 0. And these are dimension minus 1, minus 1. This is minus 1, 0 and 0, minus 1. Okay. So total dimension is again 0. is this, yeah?
G is for gauge.
G is for gauge, yes. And basically you can see that this is a super partner by taking, if you calculate the OP of lambda 0 with mu g, you will find that the OP contains the gauge vocal body support that you wrote down. Okay, when you take the OP of this with this, then you will get back the gauge body. Okay, in fact it's not lambda 0 with mu g, it's lambda 0 alpha with mu g beta dot. Okay, you have to take the corresponding beta dot to get the gauge.
That means
like the hitting body is operated, the change in that under the Grover's force function is a function is a given thing. That's it. Exactly. Okay,
but
I actually have already the capital that dot in it, basically, to get the gauge of body. That can also be important,
that
will have
this polarization part. Yeah, the polarization part of the because
you get basically linear combination of
sign,
right?
Oh, what's that? This is
what exactly. So this, when you take the OP, sigma alpha and sigma beta dot, right? There is gamma mu alpha beta dot psi mu kind of OP, and that's at the you will get the psi. So the OP is of all these sigmas are well tabulated, right? So you can work it out. Okay? I'm not listing them here because it's best to list them when we need it. Okay, instead of having to write all the OPs at the beginning, because by the time then when you need to use it, you will probably forget about it. So I will not write at least all the OPs, but all of the OPs are known. Okay, so the free, because these are chiral fields, right? All the chiral field OPs, they are known, either because they are free fields, or because they are part of the chiral algebra. Okay, and from there you can work out the OPs. Okay. And then there are two more coordinate subordinates that we need. Again, I'll not write them down now. Because ultimately, for example, if you want to calculate the one loop mass square, the mass denominator for the two chiral scalars, you remember that if we have a D-term induced, right, one particular chiral scalar should get a one loop mass square, right? And that mass square will tell us whether the C is positive or negative. Right? So for that, you need the chiral scalar for this. This I'll describe later. Okay, why you do the calculation? So now suppose we have to test if supersymmetry is broken at one point. Okay, there are many ways to test it. Right? Direct way, indirect way. The indirect way will be to calculate the mass spectrum, one loop mass denomination, and see if the bosons and fermions are the same mass. Okay? But a direct test we discussed yesterday, okay? And that's what we will try to carry out. Okay, direct test of whether supersymmetry is broken. And for that, let me remind you that what you have to check is the following. The question is this zero or not? Okay, I'll explain what the xi is. So xi gamma, as we had discussed, is any L0 class equal to 0 state with appropriate quantum. So the right kind of quantum number so that you get from 0. But then we had also said that if we suspect that it's a D term which is breaking supersymmetry, okay, that is a D term, that supersymmetry breaking could take place by this D term being generated, then xi gamma should be the conjugate to the gravity, to the U1 gauge. Right? If it's a U1 D term, you break supersymmetry. then the corresponding Goldstone will be the U1 case now. So we the first thing we should test, okay, that was that mechanism break supersymmetry, is to pick zygote with a state that is conjugate to the U1 K norm and see if this vanishes or not. Is this clear? Okay, so to choose this to be conjugate to U1 K. Okay, you are getting a part of support resistance. So conjugate in what sense? So we need xi gamma C0 minus UG beta equal to delta or epsilon r. Let me explain this notation. Epsilon beta. So you see, if you take that sigma beta, look at the sigma beta sigma 6 and sigma 6 here conjugate function. Right? In the sense that one was equal to I by 2 phi 1 plus phi 2 plus phi 3. This was equal to minus I by 2 phi 1 plus phi 2 plus phi 3. So the OP of these two will contain the identity operator. Right? Because you want the conjugate operator to be such that the product OP is just one over the identity operator over z minus order 2. Right? That's the definition of a conjugate operator. So these two are conjugate, sigma 6 and sigma 6. Okay? Because this is just equal to I by 2 phi 1 plus phi 2 plus phi 3 and this is equal to minus I by 2 phi 1 plus phi 2. Okay, you can also see it in terms of the G. Okay? The more derivative of the phi and C. Now what about these? So sigma 4 alpha has both plus. It will be I by 2 phi 1 plus phi 2. So its conjugate will be equal to minus I by 2 phi 1 plus phi. Right? Because that OP will have again your directed operator in the OP. And that to the minus I by 2 phi 1 plus phi 2 is also another sigma. Right? Not sigma dot. Right? It's a sigma alpha, not sigma alpha dot. But it's not the same sigma alpha. Right? It will be I by 2 phi 1 plus phi 2 and it will be I by 2 phi 1 plus phi 2. This OP doesn't have that. So for I by 2 phi 1 plus phi 2, you need to be minus I by 2 phi 1 plus phi 2. So the theory, that theory is what we are calling epsilon gamma. Okay? Then if this is plus plus, then this would be minus minus. And if this is minus minus, this would be plus plus. It's clear that's the definition of what we mean by epsilon gamma. So this basically what I said, this is going to be epsilon beta gamma times 1 over 3 minus 2 beta 5. And these are dimension 5-8 operators, so we will see coefficient will go around. Now let me write down the expression for xi gamma and then we can see it. So the claim is, let me write the points of it. Claim is that xi gamma is given by proportional. Okay, I'm not being very careful about normalizations. So we'll check that this is the convert. Okay, so you have to check this. Okay, and let's do it one by one. Okay, let's first check the CBOS. Check the CBOS sector. Lead sector is shown. So the matrix element should be S1. Right? So CBOS sector. Xi gamma essentially, so let me first write Xi gamma. This is C0 plus C0 bar, C1 bar, C1. Okay. Just the C goes. Okay. So forget about these parts. Then Xi gamma will be on the other hand, mu g beta is equal to 1 c1. Is this clear what you have done here? Then I forget about the spin field, but I am checking one by one. Right? So then the zero sector, it has a correct input, right? It should be one, right? In the zero sector, then we will separately check from the matter spin sector and the ghost spin sector. Okay? So in the zero sector, xi gamma is just this, right? Because c bar c creates c1 bar c1, and the lc plus the l bar c1 is just c0 plus c0 bar, right? Because in oscillator, it's this. So I take the conjugate, the dpz conjugate, so the C1s become C-1s, C0s remain C0. Mu g beta I write out from here, C bar 1, C1. And you can indeed see that when you put a C0 minus in between, you have exactly all the C0 bars, right, that are needed to get an oscillator answer. Right? Because you have C0, you have C bar minus 1, C minus 1, C bar 1, C1, sorry, C bar minus 1, C minus 1, C bar 1, C1, and then C0 plus and C0 minus is up there. Okay. So, Xi gamma C0 minus mu g beta is not square. So, this is okay. Now, I sector is easy. Y sector xi has equal to minus 3 pi by 2. Okay. So this OP goes equal to minus 2 pi over z minus w to some appropriate power. The power is in this case 4. But anyway, the important point is that this equal to minus 2 phi is exactly what you need to get a non-zero matrix element on the scale. Right? Because the picture number has to be violated by minus 2. So this is also. And finally, the manner part by construction is okay. Because this is sigma theta gamma. And this is sigma beta. Okay, so the OP is proportional to epsilon gamma beta, sigma delta. Okay. over the minus of the appropriate power. Okay, so matter part also is conjugate. Is this clear? So this is the zygote that you have to
So when you
try to test for possible violation of superstring, and if you are expecting that the violation may come from the phi angular theta, then we should check if this matrix element is non-zero for the psi gamma that we have formed. So if you want to keep track of the phases, right, you have to put in the, both the matter and both spins together, and then they go. Right? And then you will find all parts are integral parts. Right? See, here there is a 5-fold, but there also you can see there is a 3-fold. Right? Okay, so you want to keep track of the phases carefully. Right? You have to put the matter and both spins together, and then they go.
The reason I asked is that maybe you have taken this for the sign of a.
Yes.
Then it will appear as the
operator
appear as sigma
tilde sigma. Yes, that is true. You will pick out some phase, right? But as I said, I have not been keeping track of the phases anyway. Right? Because to keep track of the phases, you really have to put them together. Right? You never separate them. Right? You always want to come in after OP, but the matter and both spins are together. Okay? And then you calculate the OP. Okay, then everything is okay. Now it's also easy to check that this is BRC invariant, okay. Which of course should be the case because the conjugate of a physical state should be physical, okay. And the gradient of vortex of part of a physical state, okay. So its conjugate state should also be physical. So this is BRC invariant, it's in fact is an element of BRC, okay. So everything is fine, so now we can go ahead and start checking whether this is zero or
Zygote. Alright, because Z is zygote.
G here is really chi zero, because we are talking about it outside. Now let me remind you what K lambda 0 alpha is. Yes. Yeah, so this G, G is this integral d0 over z, car loss, right? Okay. So you want to move chi of z through c0 minus. Now chi of z has some p, okay? So it doesn't commutate c0 minus. But then the commutator, right? Of chi with c0 minus removes the c, because bc commutator removes the c, right? Result is that this is annihilated by b0 minus, this is annihilated by b0 minus. If you pick up the commutator of g with c0 minus, then the answer is 0 identically, because there is c0 minus to absorb the c0 terms, right? So you only pick up the term where the g has moved to the other side. And once it has moved to the other side, then you can just put the contour. Okay. It's a contour around everything else, right? Now you think of it's a contour around the psi which is identity. Okay. And that's how you transfer the contour psi. Okay, now this k lambda 0 alpha, okay, we have written down. We only have to calculate it up to order g square. See, in this case, because we are working at a perturbative vacuum, the expansion is in powers of ts square. Right? The kind of order ts term that will appear only if you try to move shift vacuum, right? First, pick up psi classical of order ts. Okay, that we will hopefully eventually do, but today we are just trying to stay case in the perturbative vacuum, which is possible. So this I can write as lambda 0 alpha and g equal to 1. Okay, this doesn't receive any contribution from g equal to 0. Plus psi classical lambda 0 alpha and g equal to 0. Okay, if you look at the definition of k. Okay, this is what we will write. So this has this order gs square. Okay, it has no order gs to the zero contribution because the single square bracket doesn't exist at on the sphere. This one is of order gs square because psi classical is of order gs square. Okay. Again, let me emphasize that there is no order gs contribution to psi classical because the expansion for psi classical in the perturbative vacuum is really in part of gs square. So that's the reason why you don't have to include, for example, the psi classical square lambda 0 alpha. Okay, or psi classical cube lambda 0 alpha term, because those will be higher order. Is this clear? So now I can reinterpret this as g psi gamma. Plus g is I gamma I classical. This is using the definition that a zero c zero minus a one to a zero. And I should remind you that these are all 1 pi cardinal packets. Okay, because they are the 1 pi. So this is straightforward. Okay, this is a two-point function, Rolle's two-point function, but not integrated over the full moduli space. You have to integrate only over part of the moduli space. That's the one we are using. Okay, that this is the idea. For this, you have to work a little more, because you have to work on what psi classical is. So psi classical, let me remind you to this order. Is D0 plus over L0 plus 1 minus P. Plus, I don't know what I call this, P on some state which is in the subspace, that is L0 plus kernel 0 subspace. Okay? This was a general structure. Okay, when you iterate, right, you will find that in this order, okay, this is all you have to have. Then you cannot put psi classical here because that will be hard. Is this clear? Now one can show that to this order, P acting on the square bracket actually is 0. Okay, which basically means that the square bracket, of course, it's a linear combination of many states, but it doesn't have any L0 plus equal to 0. Okay. That's the statement that the massless dipole at one loop vanishes from this one. Okay, it may not vanish at two loops, okay, but at least at one loop it vanishes. So this removing the P part is not necessary. Okay, that makes life a little simpler. So this basically means that I can just write this as D0 plus over L0 plus on this. Okay, without anything else. Okay, because if you didn't have to remove this part, okay, then you also don't have to add just this part of the solution. Okay, this is using P on this. Is that's the order of condition.
But for that bracket, you need to work at g equal to 0.
Yeah, for the curly bracket, you need to order g equal to 0. That means these are the sphere 3-point functions. But you need psi classical to order g square. Right? See, to order g square is 0, psi classical is 0. Right? So to calculate the order g square contribution to psi classical, you solve this equation iteratively. Right? And here you pick up the order g square. And that's the g equal to 1. Is this?
So this p on this is order g is
higher at g. Higher, exactly. Right? So at two loop, in fact, this vacuum does have a tadpole. The layer to tadpole is also at two loops. But at one loop, this problem doesn't exist. So you can solve the equation without having to remove anything. So this actually allows us to interpret this term nicely. Okay, and this will also illustrate some point I had mentioned earlier. Okay, without proving, okay, but the next one. So let's take the second term. And write this as G psi gamma phi by lambda 0 alpha t equal to 0 phi by psi by psi. I can always phi by c. I just introduce a complete set of states. Psi classical, I express the sum over r phi r times phi r c psi classical. Okay? So this can be written as phi r c sum over r is repeated in x, so r is sum over r. So I can write sum over r 1. So now you see that this square bracket, by definition, is anaheim by b0 minus. Okay, because it's part of h. Okay, it's an agent. So because it's part anaheim by b0 minus, I can insert e0 minus c0 minus in this. Okay, because I can always take b0 minus and counter c0 minus and act on the square bracket and make it 0. Okay, so I can have insert b0 minus c0 minus in this. And now I insert here another complicit of state, ISC minus. So let me try to write the full expression here. So you get G psi gamma phi r lambda q alpha and G equal to 0 phi r c b0 plus b0 minus 1 plus b0 plus C. And then phi s with this, right? The inner product of phi s c0 minus with this. But this by definition is phi s at g equal to 1. Is at g equal to 1, right? The same idea. So now I can give interpretation of this in the finite dimension. So the first term is just a two-point function, I have already said. Two-point function, but one PI for this. So this in the language of finite dimension, I can write this. One external leg is G xi gamma, the other one is lambda 0 alpha, and this is the one PI vortex up to G equal to 1. Okay, g equal to 0, there is a two-point vortex. Is this clear? This term, so what is this? This is a three-point function, right? G is 0, three-point function. So, g xi gamma here, lambda 0 alpha here, and phi r here. This is the probability. Right? I can rewrite this as an integral over a sin theta. See, there is also a projection upon delta L0, L0 part which I am not writing, right? Because in HN all states satisfy L0 equal to L0. So this is just a probability, right? So this is a line. And then the propagator ends with a one part function. Okay? Genus one part function. So that's basically this. This is g equal to 1. This is g equal to 0. This sum of these two is essentially the full g equal to 1. Point function of g xi gamma and lambda 0.
Because we have already summed over 1 pi.
Yes, these are 1 pi vortices, right? So if you sum over all the 1 PR diagrams using the 1 PR vertices, you are supposed to get the full 2 PR, right? And that's what we are doing. Is that clear? So this basically is the original amplitude, just the wall shape description. Whatever you have calculated as the wall shape coupon function is what we are getting. The only thing that we gain, so we didn't gain much here, but we would have gained if, for example, there was a contribution, which is that if P on this had not been 0, then this procedure would have automatically subtracted off the possible divergence that would have come from this ground problem. Here, because the divergence that this was 0, right, we didn't have to subtract the divergence, and you can get back exactly the one. So essentially this whole procedure that I have described, when there is no divergence, when you do not have to subtract anything, it gives back the usual wall-shaped description, right, which it should, because after all, we want the screen filter to reproduce the wall-shaped results, right? But when there is divergence, it tells you how to subtract. Right? In fact, subtract is often on the way, right, before you even encounter it. Right? You wouldn't have gotten this full propagator because you would have inserted 1 minus p in front of this. Right? So here, for example, you would automatically have a 1 minus p sitting inside. Okay, so what we see at the end of it is that if you want to test whether the supersymmetry is broken or not, what you have to calculate is the closest two-point function of two vertex operators. One is g xi gamma, the other one is lambda z alpha. Right? So this is what we will try to calculate next time. But so today, I will just end by writing down the expression for g xi gamma. Exercise. So G xi gamma, which is the same as chi 0 xi gamma, is given by normalization C bar C eta e to be pi by 2 okay, so basically you take this expression for xi gamma that we have here. Then you apply the picture changing operator. So I is the zero model of picture changing operator. So let me write out this quickly. So this is integral. What you have to calculate is the integral dz over z. Chi z. The z integral is about 0. Xi gamma is 0. Okay, so you have to basically look at the OP of chi z with xi gamma of 0 and pick the constant part of it. And in fact, you will find that it doesn't have any singular piece. Right? So just take z equal to 0 in this OP and pick the constant part. Right? And the constant part will give you the vertex operator. Okay? So for example, chi had one piece with a c del psi. Okay? C del psi will not contribute because when you try to take c to this, right? The cc OP is going to give you 0. So C del xi is not going to be useful. Then there is a part, it will be 5 times TF. Okay. The TF has certain singularities with sigma tilde. But it will be 5 has 0, it will be minus 3 5 by 2. And this is much stronger than the sigma. In fact, TF I think has a 1 over z minus over to be half. Whereas it will be 5 will have z minus over to be 3 half. Okay. So it basically gives you 0 again. So only the last term in the picture taking operator contributes. Right, the eta v equal to 5 kind of term. Okay, and that's what gives this. Okay. Then what we need to calculate, okay, is a two-part function of this vortex operator. This again you can check is BRST invariant. Okay, which is not a surprise because this is BRST invariant. So two-part function of this and lambda, okay, which are already written down. Lambda 0 alpha from c to the minus pi by 2. And the important point is what you will see is that if you are not very careful, right, you may conclude on the way that the result is same. So you really have to be careful in evaluating it, okay, to check if the result is zero or not. Okay, you cannot take anything for granted. So tomorrow I'll try to go through this calculation. Okay, the two-point function, the totals of these two-point functions.
And then this perceptive
way. Yes.
Have you seen in this calculation also you do we expect also?
Well, the point is there is a possibility that we saw, right? That the C could be non-zero. Right? So generically one expects that the C should be non-zero. Right? In this case, in fact, I mean, one can independently argue that if C remains zero, there would be some inconsistency because this U1, right, that we have, that becomes anomalous at 1. Okay? So the only consistent way that we know how to accommodate that is by inducing a D term, okay, and that also at the same time is a U1 base field mass.